So I think we should say a few words about the history behind why we start to develop this source code evaluation tool. All of us, the three of us, I mean, and a few more of our colleagues, we were working in some M&A company, and we have been experienced with the issues appear on acquisition and integration of a digital product. I mean, the process of evaluating a digital product in a company and integrating this digital product and transfer it to cloud is quite complicated and involves a lot of risks for both sides. The acquired company, but also the company that buy the digital product and invest money to transfer to cloud and integrate within the backbone, with a backbone. So also we found out that there is not any available tool that supports the process of technical due diligence. This is the terminology used. And source code evaluation end to end. You have to assemble your process using several commercial products or open source products. It is quite complicated. And that means only big companies could use, could implement a full end to end source code evaluation pipeline. It's quite expensive. The tools are not in the range of a few hundred dollars, it's in the range of a few $10,000. And you need a lot of time to be trained on these tools and integrate and implement a complete process. So we were working with acquisitions and integration for more than a year, and we found out the same same patterns all over. A lot of frustration in both sides. In target companies, I mean the companies, other the acquired companies, and also in our side, because we had to cope with very outdated code bases, messy code bases, lack of information, all this stuff. And from the other side, you know, each time, the company used the retrieval of all this information in order to reduce the acquisition price, okay, reduce the offer, because all these issues translated to an integration cost. And this was a pressure for the acquired company to accept a lower offer. So we had frustration from both sides, the acquired company and the integration, the company that was planning to integrate the digital product. And we thought about implementing a manual process, and we gave it a try while we were there in this company. We have implemented the first version of a manual driven pipeline, and then we automated. Pavel was the principal engineer in this case again, and we automate a big part of the steps. Leaving back this company, we discussed with Noel, and we thought about continue this work and set up a company and implement a product and offer it as a service to everybody. Small companies, medium-sized companies, and big companies. And the company has been launched late February this year, right? And it took us about 5 months to develop the prototype that we will demonstrate today, using exclusively remote working people. As we mentioned previously, we are a small team, and I think we have a very good progress. We are close to a version that could be offered. Actually, we have tested the product in several POCs already with international companies, And now we are on a beta test phase. We test the capabilities and the functionality of the application, and the plan is by the end of this month to release our first version. I don't know if Noel likes to add something on this.
Good day, everyone. Noel Alexander and Costas hit it right on the point. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, our mission is to demystify the software code evaluation process, which Costas is, you know, as already expressed, is very complicated, very difficult to rationalize. So what we want to do is demystify it, make it easy, simple, complete, affordable. And again, end to end. So you don't have to have disparate solutions. We are providing that end to end solution. So, and for all types of audiences, whether you're from a development side, your senior management in the whole code application development side, you're in the M&A space and you're evaluating companies, or you are C-suite looking for insight as to your products and so forth, our solution will address many tiers of those needs. So I'll turn it over to Costas. A great introduction on that.
Okay, so just another one comment before we proceed with the demonstration. Three different uses of this product. It could be used by developers just to check quickly, the quality of their code in the three main aspects. Code quality, compliance with the common programming practices, security compliance, and license compliance. These are the main threats for a code base, I would say, the main issues that cause damage to business. Lack of quality on coding, lack of security, and a lack of license compliance. The last is the worst because usually leads to high fines, and it's a huge danger for all companies integrating third-party software or open-source software. For a middle-level manager, I would say that it helps to keep control of the overall process, quality of the code, compliance, etc., as I've described, but also manage and distribute the resources and the budget appropriately. If, for instance, a big number of issues discovered on a small part of code base and it's all about programming violations or security, he should focus on this and resolve these issues and improve the overall quality, thus reduce the maintenance cost of the product. And when it comes to C-suite, again we need it is very useful because even a non-technical personnel could quickly run the evaluation and get a complete overview report about the quality and the status of the code base. You can, for instance, if somebody managed two or three products, he could check what is the quality, what are the main risks appear on the regarding coding of these products, and he can distribute the efforts and the budget accordingly, or set end of line on some of the product if he discovered that it's too expensive to keep maintaining this product. And this is a decision that frequently is taken based on the results of source code assessment. So let me share my screen. Do I have permission? Yes, I have permission. Okay, say.
One second, let me give you. Are you able
Do you see my screen?
Yeah, and Costas, I think just so you have more context, the people who have joined, like Tyler and Hardy, they're engineers, so individual developers, individual contributors. And then we also have Prachi, who's a QA systems engineer. So if we can just think about use cases from their perspectives, I think something that's pretty natural will be, hey, prior to joining a team, you know, do I want to assess what the code looks like? Or while I'm on a new team, you know, there are issues with the current code base. How do I present that to my engineering manager? So from those perspectives, it would be super helpful.
I could mention also a typical pain point for all remote workers. You join a new team for first time, and everybody backfire you for problems caused by people who work on the code base before you. It's always very nice to perform a 360 degrees evaluation of the code very quickly. You will see that it doesn't take more than 1 hour. And provide this report to your superiors and explain the situation and take it from there and avoid to be backfired for all the issues of the past. I think this is very useful for, especially for people, for freelancers. I have used it extensively, and also my teammates are using this when they face issues like this. So let's start to speak about the application, and you can interrupt me and we can ask whatever you like, okay? So you can get a version of our application by subscribing in our website, navigate on the download page, select the version that is suitable for with your operating system. This is an application that is running on-prem. I mean, you can run it on any computer. You don't need a special computer setup to run this application, and you don't need to any pre-installed software except the Docker engine. This is the only prerequisite, okay? That is quite typical for the, in our days. Anyway, so you can pick up any version and download the zip file, extract the executable. I have done all this just to save time, and after the version has been downloaded, you will get an executable like this. That's all you need. You don't need to install anything else. It's very simple. Once you have this executable in your computer, then the second step is to open the PowerShell and just type the name of the application like this. I don't know if it is visible. I will try to zoom in a little bit. Okay, just this. You don't need to run any other script, anything more complicated than just type the name of the application. So, a web interface appears. You have to log in with your credentials. Okay, and the first screen that appears is the dashboard. In this case, I have already run the application several times before the meeting, and this is an inventory of successful parsings of today. You can see also the execution time, and later we can click on this link and check what we get from its installation. But I would like to start a parsing, and it takes about 10 minutes. And in parallel, I could present you the results of finished parsing, and we can discuss about it. But because we need about 10 minutes to run live an application, I would prefer to start it now, and then we can discuss about the capabilities and the features, and you can ask whatever you like, of course. So let's see how we can start, what else we have on this menu. We have a new project, the new project setup. We will use this menu right after. The settings. These are general settings for all applications running in your computer. So the first tab is illustrating the settings of the Docker engine. You don't have to change this, and you should not, of course. The second tab presents the settings of code risk evaluation. Code risk is the process that retrieves hard code tokens within your code. I will explain, I will give details later, why we are looking for why we are searching for hard code token and what is the involved thread. And also the settings for code reviews. Basically, you can define some thresholds that dominate the quality of your organization, your company code base. You don't have to change anything. You can accept the default values. Just the applications provide the possibility to define your own policy, let's say, regarding code evaluation. Something that I should suggest to change is the security threshold. I use the most strict, but I think it's too much. So let's skip this one. And the license, again, a threshold. How many violations of license compliance could be considered as non-too bad? Normally, the correct number is zero, but let's use, just for an experiment, let's use the number five. Again, you don't have to change any of these parameters. I just present the possibility of configuring the evaluation process. Okay, the next step is a help. There are several keywords used on this application, and you can get a quick explanation, quick information about each keyword, each term we use, each process, either by selecting a category or checking the complete inventory. Here we have all the terms used, all the processes described in alphabetical order, all just by tapping any name here. Okay? So again, we have the dashboard that present the finished jobs, the new project definition, the settings, and the help page. And let's go quickly to the new project. Let's define the new project. So again, it's very simple. I will pick up some rather small code base. I think I have something here. So I get this one. This. Okay. You have to copy the complete path. That's all. I don't know if you can see this. I will try to zoom. Oh, no, I cannot. Okay. You have to paste the path here and give it a name. We use two identifiers, project name and product name, because somebody may want to run more than one scan for with different setup, with different configuration for a given product. Okay, now the complete process is split in two steps. The first step, we name the first step diagnostic step, and I will press this, it takes 1-2 minutes. So this part of the source code evaluation give us information about the tech stack of the code base, what programming languages have been used, what is the distribution in proprietary code, third-party code, auto-generated code. I will give you some more details right now. So in this case, you see that we see that basically we have a code base consists of, 105,000 lines of code, okay? And the biggest part is TypeScript, some JavaScript also. You see what is the distribution on programming tools and what is the classification here. Code, markup, some case configuration, okay? Also, we report the percentage of comments that we consider very important, especially for the programming languages. We should have a given percentage of comments on each file. And more or less, this is about tech stack discovery. The second tab illustrates the distribution of coding, which part of the code is proprietary code, has been built specifically for this application, which part is coming from third-party vendors, and which part of the code is auto-generated. You see, in this case, we have a quite big percentage of auto-generated code. And we can use the findings of this step in order to limit the scope of the complete parsing. Why we want to do this? Because, for instance, somebody could be interested only to maintain the coding part, not the configuration files or the auto-generated part. So it makes sense to sometimes, now frequently, to limit your analysis, your code evaluation on specific categories. For instance, programming languages only, or complete code, or it makes sense to exclude the auto-generated code, because anyway, you don't have much of control on auto-generated code. It is generated automatically. You cannot really change a lot of stuff there. And you don't. It doesn't make sense to spend effort and money trying to fix things that anyway you cannot control. So once the diagnostic phase has been completed, then you have two options. Either accept the default settings or configure the application. Just for your information, very quickly, let's see what are the default options. We have these categories. It's very simple. It's just one on-off button. Going from top to the bottom, here is this section. Configure the scope of the analysis. Only the top five programming languages. That means in our case, let's go back to code structure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 programming. Everything else will not be scanned if we select this option. I will change it later. Third party code, auto generated code. So let's customize it a bit. Let's see how it could be customized. Let's select the complete code and let's exclude only auto generated code, right? The next set of configuration parameters is referred to hard code tokens analysis, that in short we name it risk analysis. And you can select or deselect any of these categories: API keys, file names, usernames, password, domains, private keys. The next one is a little bit more sophisticated. Let me try to give a very simple definition of license. What is a license? A license is a contract between the owner of a code, of a piece of code, and the user of a code. And in general, this contract has five sections referred to the possible uses of this code. You can deploy the code on a SaaS environment, on a cloud environment. You can use it on-prem. That means include it on your product. You can modify or not modify the code. You can patent it, and you can copyright it, okay? For code development companies, mainly we are interested about the three first categories: deployment model, SaaS or on-prem, and if it is possible to modify the code without publish the modification. I mean, change, get an open source code, make your changes and keep it privately. Okay, this is basically a license. Now, there are about 570, I think, categories of license. And all these licenses issued by an organization named as PDX. We will see later some examples. And this is the, I would say, the most complicated part of a source code evaluation, and the most expensive, because it looks like a black box, even to experienced developers. Almost nobody has a clear understanding what a license means, because it's a legal document, very complicated, and usually companies get help from attorneys, lawyers, to demystify, let me use again the same word, the license meaning. This is an expensive process, and it's really a big problem when a company or a developer likes to use third party or open source code. We will see how this could be simplified. In general, there are, you can use seven different license scanners, tools that scanning for license. but we suggest only the use of Nomos and Monk, that are two supplementary license carriers, and in most of the cases cover 99% of the issues. Okay, and the last one are very simple, only control the depth of the analysis. If you like to check only the blockers, critical major bugs, and same case for security. So let's start the analysis, and then we can see some reports. Once the analysis starts, we have a monitor page. Left to right, we have the steps of the analysis and some visual indication of the status of the analysis. Okay. I'm not so proud about this circle. I like it. I like the circle, but it's too hard to fine tune the time estimation. And it's a little bit misleading. It gives an estimation of the overall passing time, but definitely it takes a little bit more. We will see. In this case, I think we need about 12 to 15 minutes maximum. Okay, so let's leave it running in the background and let's see what we get if the analysis has been completed. I will use any example. We can choose whatever. Okay, I don't know. Let's take Kubernetes. That is used by almost everybody. It's by the way, let me go back. Intentionally, we have chosen these as test cases because these are the 10 most visited repositories on GitHub during 2019. It's not a random chosen list. We just pick up the top 10, okay? And we perform some analysis. And let's see what we get. Regarding tech stack, Kubernetes basically consists of a big part of Golang. Okay, I don't know if it is, let me try to zoom in a little bit. It's visible, I think. It's a big part of configuration and everything else is just a small percentage. So as you see, Kubernetes mainly is written in Go language. So if you like to modify it or get improve Kubernetes, it's good to have quite a lot of Go developers. And this is a very first conclusion of the tech stack analysis. We have seen many times that the distribution of developers is not matching the distribution of tech stacks. You can see a company that has, for instance, 10 Java developers and only 5% or 10% of the code is Java. Or vice versa. Only one .NET developer, only one Go developer, and 70% of the code is written in Go. So this is an obvious drawback. And it's very easy to discover issues like this. Okay, so we can also check the structure. It's half proprietary code written specifically for Kubernetes. Quite a lot of code used in other products too, and a rather small part of auto-generated code. Now, let's check the static code analysis result, the code reviews. So, as it was expected, we don't have blockers, otherwise nothing would work in our real world. Everything is based in Kubernetes nowadays, whatever we use. Most possibly there are some Kubernetes installation behind. There are no blockers, but there are quite a lot of code smells. I mean, violation of programming practices. Thankfully, not blockers. And surprisingly, you can see that we have a few vulnerabilities. Even in a code base that is used by, literally speaking, by millions every day. It's a real result. I just have scanned the code today. I have downloaded the new version of the latest version of Kubernetes, and you see, even the latest version, again, we have 19 security vulnerabilities, and we can see some details. The tool provided, C2M provided also a detailed report, and you can see left to right again where the issue appear. The type of the issue, what exactly is the issue, the severity, and the exact line within the file. And you can select or deselect the issues of your interest. later we will see how we can extract a report out of it. Okay? So this is about static code analysis. Let's move to code risks. Again, now this is a big discovery, at least for me. There are quite a lot of issues, hard code tokens within Kubernetes data code base, mainly on test part, but also on the core code. And let's see some of the details. Just for demonstration purpose, we present here only the top part of the complete report. You can see the details, the type of the issue. You can filter this too by type or using any other attribute. And you can select some of these to include on your report. I will present the report right after. But let's close this part. Security analysis, similarly, we can see the vulnerabilities and the details of the vulnerabilities. What exactly is an issue within current database? Potentially, I have to emphasize on this. All the available scanners using some patterns, okay? It doesn't mean that it's necessarily a problem, but definitely it's an issue require attention, okay? There is a difference between a real problem and a potential problem. But also a potential problem is it might cause issues in a live environment, and it always makes sense to reduce as much as possible these issues before deploy your code. There are several studies, and you can just Google it, and you can see that a problem resolved in during development time, let's say that it costs $10. During test time, it costs 10 times more or more, $200 or $1,000. And if you discover the problem after deployment, it might cost $10,000 or even more. The increase of the maintenance cost, the cost is increased exponentially. So it makes sense to eliminate as many as possible of the issues before deployment. And let's go to the last tab, license compliance. Not something risky, only this. We have a GPL, thankfully it's on a test file, I have checked it. And this is what I mentioned previously, by clicking on the identifier, automatically you're transferred to the exact description of the license. And you can see what exactly the license contract is including. But very quickly, we have classified the license using the basic categories. If it is allowed to deploy this code in SaaS, yes, you can do it. If it's allowed to distribute this code within your package, yes, but it's not allowed to modify the code. If you modify this Kubernetes code, you have to deploy the complete application again under the same license scheme. That means LGPL 3.0, and this is a risk. And we were expecting this. Of course, you cannot claim that Kubernetes is your code. You cannot sell it, basically, okay? This is the idea of LGPL 3. Okay, I don't want to go deeper into detail, just a quick view on how the detailed report looks like. And finally, a very simple report, an overview. This is basically for your managers, for C-suite, for executives. The people that they don't like to spend a lot of time on the details that we just presented, but they just want to have an overview of the complete thing. So we use again the traffic light convention: green if nothing is dangerous, red if require attention, and okay, unit test coverage is not ready yet. This is why it is gray. If it is orange, means that you can bypass it basically. Okay, so finally, you can export a PDF by using this bot. And we can see how the report looks like. An overview. and some the details that we just discussed. Just have discussed. Okay. Of course, you can get the detailed reports, but it's quite consuming now. There are a lot. I will not use it in this code base by clicking here. And more or less, this is what you get out of a C2M license, C2M assessment tool. Let's see if the. No, it's still running. I don't know if there are questions or anything that we can discuss waiting for the application to finish, or if any of my colleagues like to add anything. Noel, do you have any comment, anything to add?
No, basically, as you can see, the product has a great deal of configurability and its preset presettings in there so that you don't have to, you know, where our recommendations are, but you have the flexibility of making some adjustments and customizations based on your particular needs. In addition, we try to make the product, the flow very easy from a standpoint of, you know, usability and then functionality. So you see how, as Costas is showing you here, how the assessment is being performed, and then give you, you know, comprehensive reports where you can drill down and execute actions accordingly.
Okay, I think we need 2 or 3 minutes more to complete the analysis. So let me pick up again the report that we have produced in this case. Our plan is to offer an editable version of this report. That means we will provide the possibility to add your comment and mark somehow the issues that you consider as important that need maintenance and need attention. So once the product will be released, we will provide the possibility to customize and configure your report. Now, if you remember previously, I presented some the configuration of some thresholds. The thresholds are used to produce this row. Depends on the configuration, the settings each company is using, the quality criteria each company is using, the report may be different for the same code base. There are companies, for instance, that do not accept any vulnerability, even if it is a minor risky vulnerability. There are other companies, depends on the market sector. For instance, a banking company, a fintech company should always offer absolutely clear code because the risk is too high. Some other company like an e-commerce or marketing company, maybe it's not so strict in regarding this aspect. So the tool will provide the possibility to configure your source assessment policy, and customize as you like. Any question, any comment up to this point? So let's go back. I think now I should have been finished. It needs some more time. I remember that it takes or either 14 or 15 time minutes, but maybe the saving screen delayed a little bit more, but let's wait, it will be finished as we speak. Don't worry about
it. Maybe we can go over how does the beta program work, and
yes,
what are some expectations from you?
Okay, so the idea is to start the beta testing. It was planned to start a little bit earlier, but we have decided to add a few more capabilities during the last days. So we have postponed for a few days. Most possibly we will start the beta testing program next week. So the process will be simple. I mean, if somebody likes to participate on the beta testing, he should be subscribed on the website and send us a mail. I would like to help you with the beta testing program. And then our marketing team, led by Noel, will arrange a first call something similar with today's call, but we will we like to get some more information regarding the use of the application. What is your interest? How you, what are your pain points? What you would like to see on the application, and then we will offer a free license, and you can scan your code as many times you like, and we can help you also with the evaluation of the code base. Of course, any feedback, any remark is very valuable, but this pretty much the process. Just be subscribed on the website, send us an email. I would like to participate on the beta testing project, and then we will take it from there and we will arrange a call with you, and we will provide all the information and the support you need to go through the beta test process. Of course, we will. We have already a list of friend companies and, that have offered to participate, but the more the better, I would say, because there most possibly there are a lot of corner cases and cannot be discovered by a small team like CodeWeTrust team.
Well, that's really wonderful. Thank you so much for providing this opportunity to the Braintrust engineering community. I think, you know, I thought it was really interesting seeing the different types of codes and also potential of finding security concerns. And, you know, I'm thinking maybe if you want to run this, and because it looks like it's still waiting for 16 more minutes, we can send this.
We have to wait for 2 or 3 minutes, not for 16 minutes, for two minutes.
Oh, where does it say?
Yes.
Oh, total expected time. Got it. Okay.
So we don't have to wait that much. I think it takes less than 20, definitely, but I told you, let's wait. If the time is elapsed, we can stop it. But anyway, now we have the last step. It will be finished in 1 to 3 minutes maximum. I think it's the whole idea is to offer something that it's very simple to install. This is a big problem with the existing offer in the market. If anybody has experience of trying to set up a pipeline like this, he will find out that he has to contact a lot of companies, provide a lot of information, pay tons of money, and go through a very complicated process to set up the pipeline. The second problem that you will face is that each tool offers a completely different report. So you have to manually combine the reports provided by any of these tools in order to have a full assessment. And the worst I have already mentioned, some of the reports are very hard to be parsed by somebody that is not experienced with the legal terms of used in license compliance discovery. Our idea was to simplify all this and offer something that you can install it on the spot. You don't need any other software than this and get a complete report. And please believe me, this report that you have seen is more than enough to drive an acquisition. Rarely companies are using something more advanced than what you have seen during due diligence, technical due diligence. I mean, usually it's much less informal. I think this is a very comprehensive report, and it's a superset of whatever we have seen so far. So this is the idea, simplification, make it affordable for everybody and make it complete, not just a part of the process. Now it has been finished. So we can export, you can see how much time, I think, 18 minutes in all. We can export the report just very quickly and see what we get here. So that's it. So as you have seen, it's not any black magic behind. You just get an executable, run it, and you get the report. No tricks. So that's it. I don't know if there are some questions or any comment for
If I may just jump in here, given the audience that's on the phone, the participants, maybe we should ask about if you've used code assessment tools, and based on your experience of those tools, how do you see this product aligning with your experiences and so forth? Anyone?
Maybe this is something is more hands-on. People have to get their hands on their experience.
In general, the technical due diligence is covered by mystery. Everybody hears the term technical due diligence. Oh, wow, what is this? It's super complicated, something dangerous. They treat it like a virus. But as you see, it's a very simple thing. It consists of some steps, and if you go through the process step by step, you can quickly get all you need and move on. It's not something super complicated. Even it is presented like something complicated. So anyway, if anybody on the network is interested on using a tool like this or exchange thoughts, he can send us a message, he can give us his feedback, or he can ask whatever he needs if somebody likes to see some additional functionality or some different functionality. I would be happy to discuss this topic and consider it as a possible extension improvement of our tool. Just to close this discussion, the next step is a SaaS version of the tool. That means instead of downloading the application, you can be connected on in our SaaS environment, and link your application, I mean your version control system, and get the results in our server. The SaaS version will include also monitoring possibility. That means you can check the trend of the status of your code. You can check if the vulnerabilities increased or decreased. You can check if the code review results are getting better or worse, and if you have cleaned most of the license in compliance down the road. So this is a very, I think, very useful addition to our tool to offer the possibility to check the trend of code quality. It's very common in early stages of, especially talking about startups, the early version of a code base is quite dirty because everybody's running to deliver an MVP. Later, the code base is getting better, and when the biggest share of market achieved, the code is getting terrible. So you have these two peaks. But in the beginning, quite good in the meantime, in the middle, and much worse at the end. And if you don't take care of the quality of the code, then the maintenance cost is increased, and this is a super big threat for all new companies.
I do have a quick question. But do you support Swift, and what is the list of languages that you currently support?
Yes, we support Swift too. We have 25, currently there are supported 25 programming languages, and we cover almost 97, I think, of the used languages based on GitHub statistics. Basically, most of the steps are agnostic, language agnostic. Only the code reviews are, we use a dedicated scanner for each specific programming language, but Swift is covered, yes.
I have one question, does it configurable to Jenkins?
Configurable, sorry, I did not hear it.
Does it configurable to Jenkins? Like CI/CD pipeline for Jenkins?
Not this version. The next version that will be released according to our roadmap at the end of the year, it could be integrated on Jenkins, but also it could be used in a smarter way. I mean, you can run the analysis not each time you commit a new change on the code, but you can have an event trigger or a time trigger, scanning of your code. That means you can scan, you can parse the code every day or every time that you have a major release or every time you integrate some third-party library. So these are the possibilities. To scan your code on every commit you see that it's quite fast, or before any major release, or after you have integrated a third-party library that always introduces a lot of issues. This will be the possibilities, but not of this version. Of course, nobody forbids it. I mean, there is no any restriction. It's just an executable. You can configure Jenkins to run this executable, but it's not suggested. That's all I'm saying. You can run it, of course. But it's not the preferred solution, I would say. Okay? Any other question? So I think we are approaching also the end of this meeting. Before we close, I would really like to thank you again for the invitation and for the opportunity to present the application outside our organization. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your demo today. We'll follow up with an email to everyone on this group so we can get your beta testing set up.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.